Well, welcome back. So Unit 5 has sort of pulled together all of the concepts and terms and concepts that we have been discussing in this course. So by reviewing Unit 5, I'll actually largely be reviewing the course. So the goal of Unit 5 was to try to begin by mathematically defining the semiconductor problem. We have three quantities we're after. We're after the two carrier densities and the electrostatic potential, or equivalently, we're after the two quasi-Fermi potentials and the electrostatic potential. And we formulated a set of equations to give us those quantities. The first one was the hole continuity equation. There was also an electron continuity equation. Our generation terms here, we were indicating those explicit generation processes such as optical generation or impact ionization. There are also recombination terms that can be positive or negative, and when they're negative, they're also generation processes. The current equation, if we write it in drift diffusion form, you can see that it has an electric field. That means that there is an electrostatics problem. We also need an equation for the electric field. And we talked about where that equation comes from. That's really the electrostatics problem. That's Gauss's law. We can express Gauss's law in this integral form, which relates the charge enclosed in a volume to the integral of the normal component of the displacement field across the surface of that volume. And there is also a differential form that we use more commonly in these problems. Divergence D is equal to rho, the space charge density. Remember, D is related to the electric field by the relative dielectric constant and epsilon naught, the permittivity of free space. So we'll write our equation for the electric field in this form. And the charge comes from two sources, the mobile carriers and from the dopants, the ionized dopants that we introduce into the semiconductors. So these sets of equations, a continuity equation for holes, a continuity equation for electrons, and Gauss's law, divergence D is equal to rho, give us the equations that describe the operation of semiconductor devices. We augment these equations with a set of constitutive relations that relates the currents and the space charge density to the unknowns that we're dealing with in these equations. All right. Now, in general, those equations can be a little complicated. Sometimes they can be very complicated to solve. So we talked about a very powerful technique, the use of energy band diagrams to provide us with qualitative solutions to that set of equations. One of the important principles that we use when drawing equilibrium energy band diagrams is to remember that the Fermi level is constant. Okay, we use that as a starting point when we're drawing these energy band diagrams. This is what an energy band diagram might look like. We generally see bands bending, sometimes, not always, in an interesting semiconductor device. We can read an energy band diagram like this and determine quantities of interest when we're trying to understand the operation of a device. We can determine the electrostatic potential simply by flipping conduction band, valence band, or intrinsic level upside down. That gives us potential versus position. We can read the electric field off by just taking the slope of one of those bands. We can relate the electron density or the hole density to how far above or below the intrinsic level the Fermi level is. So here we see the Fermi level is below the intrinsic level. The semiconductor is p-type here. Here we see the Fermi level is above the intrinsic level, so the semiconductor is n-type near the surface. And we can also deduce the space charge density from a plot like this as well. We talked about how one draws equilibrium energy band diagrams. We begin with the Fermi level and just draw a straight line because we know it's constant. And then we can usually deduce in regions that are far away from the regions where things are changing, carrier concentrations may be uniform, and we can put in those regions of the device in which the carrier concentration is uniform, and then smoothly connect things up, and we'll have our complete energy band diagram. So equilibrium energy band diagrams is a process for drawing energy band diagrams and understanding the solutions. out of equilibrium, we generalize our equilibrium results by introducing these quantities that we called quasi-Fermi levels. We need one for electrons and one for holes, and they're analogous to the Fermi level that we use in equilibrium conditions. Now, we also talked about, you know, going beyond qualitative solutions, we talked about actually solving these equations. And to solve these equations, one way to solve these equations is to simplify them. And for certain specific problems that are commonly encountered, we can simplify these equations to the point where they can be solved relatively easily. And for problems that focus on minority carriers in low-level injection, these equations can be greatly simplified. So we work through an example. So here's an example of an N-type semiconductor, and we're interested in solving those equations for minority carrier holes. So we know the electron concentration. We don't need to solve anything there because in low-level injection, everything stays the same for the majority carriers. We write down the hole continuity equation. If we assume that we have optical generation, we simply specify that the generation process is generation due to light. If we have low-level injection, then the hole concentration is essentially the excess concentration, which overwhelms the equilibrium holes. If we assume there's no electric field, then our current equation has only a diffusion component, no drift component. And if we assume that the diffusion coefficient is uniform with position, we can pull it out of the derivative, and we get this equation, which is known as a minority carrier diffusion equation, that describes the behavior of minority carriers in semiconductors. We can solve this equation then for different cases of interest. The first step is to write down this equation and make sure that the simplifying assumptions that I just went through are valid. In N-type semiconductor, we would be after the minority carrier hole concentration. In a P-type semiconductor, we would be after the minority carrier electron concentration. Depending on the specifications of the specific problem, we may be able to simplify the equation. We can then solve that equation for the minority carrier density. Once we have the minority carrier density, because there's always a relation between carrier concentration and quasi-Fermi level, once we've solved the minority carrier diffusion equation for the minority carrier concentration, we can then deduce the minority carrier quasi-Fermi potential. We discussed the general features of these solutions. Transient solutions go exponentially as e to the minus t over minority carrier lifetime. Steady state solutions in long regions go exponentially as e to the minus x over diffusion length. And steady state solutions in short regions, short compared to a diffusion length, are linear. So understanding these general features of the solutions allows us sort of to intuit the solution to this minority carrier diffusion equation under situations that we encounter. So just to wrap up Unit 5 and really to wrap up the course, we have discussed in this unit the basic equations that describe the operation of a wide variety of semiconductor devices. They're not as fundamental as Maxwell's equations. There are some assumptions involved, especially in these current equations, but they're remarkably and broadly useful as a starting point for understanding the operation of semiconductor devices. We've mentioned that these equations can be solved numerically on a computer. We discussed a very powerful technique with energy band diagrams for understanding qualitatively the solutions to these equations. And we've shown how, under some specific conditions, we can simplify these equations greatly to the point where we can analytically solve them and understand the solutions. So if you've understood all of the various discussions that have led to this set of equations, generation, recombination, current transport, Fermi levels, quasi-Fermi levels, and everything that goes into that, you're well prepared. You have a good, solid understanding of semiconductor fundamentals that will prepare you to understand the physical operation of almost any device that you encounter. And finally, as you're summarizing Unit 5, there are a number of terms that were introduced as we discussed the concepts in this unit. You might refresh your memory about what each of these terms means, so that if you encounter a colleague and you're talking semiconductors, you'll be able to have a discussion in terms of some common terms that semiconductor people frequently rely and make use of. So thank you for sticking with me in Unit 5, and thank you for participating in this course. I hope you found it a useful way to understand semiconductor fundamentals.